o'clock. We'll call this meeting of the Del Norte Local Transportation Commission to order and start with Pledge of Allegiance.
Salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Moving down the agenda, public comment period. Anyone wishing to make public comments regarding matters either on or off the agenda and within the commission's jurisdiction may do so at this time. However, the commission is not permitted to act on non-agenda items. Is there any public comment? Seeing no public comment, we'll adjourn to the Policy Advisory Committee and move on to the consent agenda.
Motion to approve, Chair.
Any discussion on the consent agenda?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Would you please poll the vote, please?
Public comment?
I did it already, but let's not poll the vote yet. Is there any public comment on the consent agenda? I even mentioned earlier that I was going to try not to forget that, and I already did it, so apologies for that. Seeing no public comment, can we now poll the vote? Thank you.
Commissioner Fallman?
Yes.
Commissioner Gitlin?
Yes.
Commissioner Hemmingson?
Yes.
Commissioner Howard?
Yes.
Policy Advisory Member Robertson?
Yes.
And Chairman Short?
Yes.
And Commissioner Keim?
Yes.
Thank you for that. Consent agenda is passes unanimously. Moving on to policy administrative.
Mr. Chair, point of order.
Yes.
Under item D, and I don't know if this would qualify that. I don't know if you have seen this letter. This is fresh off, and I don't think it's agendized. I don't know if we're in the ability to agendize this letter from Congressman Huffman regarding a request for monies from the funding for the California Transportation Commission. It needs to have a May 1st postmark on it, and I don't think it's on the agenda. Tamara, is it on the agenda as an exigent item?
No, this is an item that came to us after the posting of the agenda on Friday. I would suggest that we can add it to the agenda. It's really at the discretion of the commission. But it certainly did come to us after the posting of the agenda. I think it came to us on Tuesday, maybe.
The meeting was Monday, so can this board, Mr. Chairman, can this board take this up as an exigent item and add this to the agenda, or is that inappropriate?
I'd actually recommend that we do take it up as a matter of emergency item because it does need to be in Sacramento by a certain date.
And I'll second that.
I think that is absolutely appropriate.
That having been said, Mr. Chairman, I think it's appropriate to read the letter. If that's okay, so everyone is aware of this. I don't know if city council members are aware of this letter.
We all got the letter.
Okay, everyone. Mr. Fallman,
yeah, it's widely distributed.
Mr. Robertson, are you familiar with this letter? Okay, so pretty much everybody except Mr. Robertson knows this letter. And if we are going to discuss it today, I would like Mr. Robertson to know what he's putting his vote for. So I'll give that to you, sir. And if we can discuss that at this meeting, that would be helpful.
I think bringing it as an emergency item is appropriate. Also, reading the letters is appropriate as well. That should probably happen prior to public comment on this emergency item before we pull this. So, Mr. Gitlin, would you mind?
Absolutely. And I'm going to read this as though it were sent, because the motion which I will proffer to the board will be
Mr. Chairman, if we could vote to have it added to the agenda, and then as we take up the item, then read the letter, I think would be more appropriate.
Okay.
We've already had a motion to add it to the agenda, then once we bring it up...
I guess it's not officially added to the agenda, I see what you're saying. Yes, you're absolutely right, Mr. Hamilton, thank you. So Nicole, would you pull the vote to add this emergency item to the agenda?
Commissioner Kime?
Yes.
Commissioner Hamilton?
Yes.
Commissioner Gitlin?
Yes.
Commissioner Howard?
Yes.
Commissioner Fallman?
Yes.
Policy Advisory Member Robertson?
Yes.
Chairman Short?
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Jerry. Now that it's been added to the agenda, prior to public comment for this item, let's go ahead and proceed with the reading of the letter.
Okay, this is a letter, it's a draft language from Congressman Jared Huffman's office. It's addressed to Bob Alvarado, who is the chairman of the California Transportation Commission in Sacramento. It said, "Dear Mr. Alvarado," and I'm going to change one thing because my motion, when we make this motion, will be one in which we have seven wet signatures rather than from the you, the chairman, Mr. Chairman Short. So it'll say, "We are writing in strong support of the California Department of Transportation's request for funding to perform environmental clearance in geotechnical investigation of a potential new alignment on US Highway 101 between Klamath and Crescent City near the area known as Last Chance Grade. The funding is a critical step in ensuring the coastal highway does not experience a major failure or require continuation of the constant maintenance of the past several decades. Caltrans has spent well over $40 million maintaining the current alignment on Last Chance Grade since 1981. Last year, Governor Jerry Brown proclaimed of a state of emergency due to damage caused by El Nino storms in Del Norte County. This winter, significant damage occurred at Last Chance Grade, including a new slide which collapsed a lane of the highway, and weeks later, a slide which closed the highway for several hours. Caltrans is actively engaged with the Federal Highways Administration on negotiating the use of emergency relief funds to repair the damage and keep essential traffic flowing on the existing roadway. A significant failure at Last Chance Grade would force a detour of approximately 320 miles or 6 to 8 hours. Caltrans has estimated a full closure of the route would cost the local economy alone approximately $130 million per year." In this case, I'll put in the organization. "The Del Norte County Local Transportation Commission is part of a stakeholders group convened by Congressman Jared Huffman, Democrat San Rafael, which is made up of representatives of county governments, tribes, environmental groups, landowners, business, and transportation interests that agree a new alignment is necessary. Caltrans is also working closely with resource and permitting agencies and tribes to address environmental and cultural concerns in advance. The California Transportation Commission funding under consideration would allow Caltrans to initiate studies and investigations of potential alignments of the highway around Last Chance Grade to protect the safety and economy of Del Norte County and the people and commerce that travels US Highway 101. Please give this funding your full and fair consideration." It's signed, and again, I'm going to ask for five or seven wet signatures so it shows unanimity on our governance, not just the chairman. And this would be need to be postmarked no later than May 1st. That's the letter.
If I could, I have some suggested changes that I drafted this letter. And I took the draft of the letter and I made some revisions to it. I changed very little at the suggestion of Congressman Huffman's office, but I started the letter saying, "As the Regional Transportation Planning Agency, we are writing in strong support." So I added that. It's especially pertinent to the California Transportation Commission, who is keenly aware of what the regional transportation planning agencies are in the state. The other addition that I made in that first paragraph is I noted that this is our first priority project in our regional transportation plan. And that, too, the regional transportation plan is a very meaningful document to the California Transportation Commissioners and the role that that document has in priority setting in the state. So I added those two, you know, one sort of a partial introduction acknowledging that we are the RTPA for Del Norte and the other noting that Last Chance Grade is our first priority project. In anticipation of this being added to the agenda, I prepared the letter in two ways, and one of them has space for the six signatures of the Transportation Commissioners. It wouldn't be appropriate for Jesse Robertson as a policy advisory member to sign the document, but it does have all of your six names on it if you were to choose to take that action. I also prepared a letter of support just with the chairman's signature on it. As a practice, though, just so you can all keep this in mind, if this did not come up before a meeting and we had this deadline, say this meeting was next week, I would have gone ahead and prepared the letter. I do so on a routine basis for projects that are high priorities in a regional transportation plan without coming back to the commission and asking for additional support. We adopt the regional transportation plan by resolution, and that, you know, affirms to me that these are the priorities in our region, so I don't come back to you. I do come back to you every time I write a letter if there's anything involved that includes staff time or commission resources in any way to, you know, participate in moving a project forward. That's always been the practice of the commission. If you would like for me to do something differently, I can, but I do find it extremely cumbersome every time I'm asked for a letter to support to have to bring that letter back to the commission when they are high priority projects in our regional transportation plan already.
Thank you, Tamara. I guess this time we'll open this letter that was just read up to for public comment and any further discussion among commission. Is there any public comment about the letter that was just read that will or will not be sent to the chairman of the California Transportation Commission? Seeing no public comment, I will bring it back to the commission. Is there any further discussion?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make that motion with the suggestions and changes per Executive Director Tamara Layton to have this letter drafted, and if it's successful in being unanimously passed, I'm going to presume, Ms. Layton, you'll do the legwork and getting it to everybody.
I've already done that. It's here in the meeting today. In anticipation that you might take that action, so I actually don't have to do that legwork.
Okay, so I'll make that motion at the time to adopt the letter to send.
Second that motion.
Just clarification, she anticipated that the letter would be considered one way or the other, so she has gotten.
So do I need to clarify this is six witness signatures?
Yes. I think that was the motion you made.
Yep, I did.
Yep.
And that was
so,
my second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Is there any public comment on sending this letter? Seeing no public comment, I'll bring it back to the commission for a polled vote. Nicole, if you would.
Commissioner Fahlman?
Yes.
Commissioner Hemmingson?
Yes.
Commissioner Keim?
Yes.
Commissioner Gitlin?
Yes.
Commissioner Howard?
Yes.
Policy Advisory Member Robertson?
Yes.
And Chairman Short?
Yes. Thank you all for that. Okay.
It's unanimous.
Now we'll move on to item D, our Last Chance Grade project update. Yes?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for having me here today. I'm Jamie Mattioli.
Yep.
Raise this up a bit.
Thank you,
Jamie. Very much. Yeah, everybody can hear me okay. Caltrans project manager. I've taken over the Last Chance Grade project from Sebastian Cohen, previous project manager. And the good news is that Sebastian stays on as he's known as the program manager. He manages the storm damage program for Caltrans District 1. So we retain Sebastian's expertise and on the project, which is a big benefit. So I look forward to a long relationship with this commission here. Thanks for having me here today. So I want to give an update, and most of this, I think folks have heard who were at the Huffman meeting the other day, and it's out in the media already, so there's nothing really surprising here today, but I want to talk about the recent movement of the road at Last Chance Grade. We'll talk about efforts to repair storm damage at the grade, the current efforts to maintain the road and fix the road. And then I'll talk about the $5 million worth of funding proposed that was just discussed in the letter that you approved. And then we'll cover a separate effort to pursue full funding of the realignment project. So first on recent movement, we heard from Geotech that's been, they study movement in various ways. They have a number of instruments out there, and they also go out and survey the road every season or so, at least twice a year. So there's one location near Wall 3, which is on the uphill side of the road, the northern part of the section where you see a crack in the road and the boards are missing from that. So this is the location where we're talking about. We've seen 11 feet since 2012, as the congressman mentioned, of horizontal movement. That's towards the west or towards the ocean. And 6.3 feet vertical movement and dropping. And just this winter, since October, it's been a wet year, we've seen 3 feet of horizontal movement, and we've seen 2.3 feet of vertical movement. So with that movement there, we also have movement in other locations, and of course we at post mile 14-4, we had a nested slide and partial failure damage to the roadway, which ultimately closed the southbound lane. And we drove by today and saw some of the work there. The temporary fix was to put in vertical piles through the location, and now they're putting in what's known as a soil nail wall. They're patching it up, and ultimately they'll have a new retaining wall that stretches from the retaining wall to the north where there was damage, the Wilson Creek wall, past that location where we had the slip out. And so that work is included in a damage assessment form that has been submitted by Sebastian Cohen, Storm Damage Coordinator, to FHWA. And in total, that request is asking for $35 million in storm damage work to repair the roadway, including that location, including four other retaining walls, either extending them or repairing them, and corrections to the profile of the roadway, so the vertical shape of the roadway to correct where we've had dips. There's a lot of work included in that. Also included in that DAF are two locations that we are watching closely, so we could come back and amend this form, damage assessment form, in the near future if we see more damage out there. So we left that open. The FHWA is still considering the form, and they have not signed it yet, but we have been working with them very closely. We've met them out on the grade, I believe 2 weeks ago, and on numerous other occasions, and Sebastian works very closely with those folks. So we anticipate support of that DAF. And that DAF also includes an effort, which I'll cover at the end, to study the geotechnical issues on the entire grade, the full 3 miles, and to form a team to perform a risk assessment. And those efforts are really going into achieving or not achieving support, either one, for the full realignment. So that's a separate effort to repairing the roadway, but it's included in that DAF. And we just heard the letter about my next item, about the $5 million that we're programming. So there was a change in the policy from FHWA for the last few years. FHWA told us that we would not be eligible for the emergency relief program if we program funds for what's known as zero phase or the environmental phase. And Tamara, I believe, have you passed out that?
No, that'll come up later in the agenda, but Last Chance Grade is on there.
Oh, excellent.
It's a chart that explains the phases of highway development, so we'll be talking about that later in the meeting.
It's a wonderful chart. So if you see that chart, I've got it up in my office. You'll see that right now we've only been working in the planning phase, the next phase of the project goes into the environmental phase. It's just a wonderful picture as you look at it. So we're actually beginning, the $5 million is a jumpstart to that environmental phase. It's not fully funding the environmental phase. The estimate in the 2016 project initiation report was that it would cost us $52 million to fully fund that environmental phase. But this $5 million gets us the funding that we need, which would allow us to work continuously until we have full funding, if that is achieved by the summer of 2018. So it could allow us to have that jump start and put us on the critical path. Again, we're doing the geotech investigations where we can, and we're producing a plan for to perform all the geotech investigations. We may not be able to perform all those within the next year, all those either drilling or seismic refraction or other studies, but we'll have a plan in place for how we strategically drill. And we're also doing the environmental work to get that drilling done, so producing the environmental document, which is separate than the document we would have for a full realignment. This document just allows us to do the drilling and the permits to do the drilling. And so those activities put us on the critical path to completing the environmental work down the road. And of course, during this next year, assuming we're successful in getting this funding, we'll continue our partnerships with our three working groups, Huffman's group, our other working group, as we call it, and our biological working group. And I want to reiterate that the full realignment project remains unfunded and unapproved at this time. So working towards funding the project, as I mentioned in the DAF, we include funds, a request for funds to convene a team to perform the risk assessment and also to produce a comprehensive geotechnical report. And those two items will help inform the decision that FHWA will make on whether they approve a full realignment of Last Chance Grade. And so that effort should begin this summer, and it is hoped that it could be completed by the summer of 2018.
Is that the full geotechnical study on the 3 miles of Last Chance Grade that
was
requested?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's a separate geotech investigation than what we're talking about with the $5 million. So there's studies that need to be performed on the existing alignment. We have a lot of data already on that alignment, but we're putting it all together, seeing where we have gaps, and we'll perform additional studies if needed to fill those gaps. Yeah.
Jamie, I want to make sure I heard the same thing Monday that I'm hearing now.
Yes.
The $35 million, which you're not sure we're going to get, is going to work on the current alignment on the west side of the mountain.
Yes.
Possibility you don't get it. What happens if you don't? We don't get this federal highway money? Does Caltrans forge ahead and keep the road open anyway? They'll have funding for that.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
I think it's a very high likelihood that we do get that funding. Yes.
Now, my understanding on the $5 million, which I'll call on the east side of the mountain, was going to be doing drilling for some of the proposed routes.
Yeah.
So it doesn't have, does that mean it's, you're going to be doing drilling on an existing coastal? Because I think the rules call for all roads, including the existing alignment, has to be studied.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to be using funds to even examine the existing route of those, not not just the new ones.
There's a potential for that. That's a very good question. We do have the separate funding that we're getting out of the $35 million portion that is looking at the comprehensive geotech study. So that will be fully funded, and we can use that information when we're looking at the realignment project. So we may not need to fund the west side drilling out of, I like how you
put
that.
Thank you for that clarification. Yes. I know I heard something similar to that. It's a little different than I'm hearing today from the Monday stakeholders group. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Any other questions from the question?
Yeah. Oh, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Jamie.
Appreciate it.
You're lucky, Debbie.
Okay. Moving on down the agenda, we'll move on to item E, the appointment of a Del Norte Local Transportation Commission member to U.S. Congressman Huffman's Last Chance.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, I'd like to throw my name out there as the longest standing member of this commission and have always been supportive of Congressman Huffman's efforts in his stakeholders group. I just like to throw my name in the hat I'd be more than willing to accept that position if you choose to appoint.
Thank you, Jerry. Just to let the commission know, I'm certainly also available, but absolutely would support Jerry as a ranking member here to that commission, or to that position, excuse me. Is there any public comment on this appointment to this position? No public comment.
Do you know if the city council and board of supervisors are going to end up sending their own appointees to that stakeholders group as well?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
Yeah, the city council has a representative, as mm-hmm. does the county supervisors, as does the transportation commission, as does some other agencies in the region.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to throw my name in as an appointee for this. I think our board has already decided which direction it's going to go. We do have some differences of opinion, so I'd like to throw my name into that as a potential appointee for the stakeholders group from the Del Norte Local Transportation Commission. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gitlin. Any further discussion? Any motion?
I'm sorry, as a point of order, it's been our practice in the past when we've, I mean, it's very rarely that we've done it, and you guys can handle this in whatever way we want, but in the past we've had this be an appointment of the chair and not a voted on item, but again, we have rarely had committees that we've sat on like this in the past. So just the practice of the commission has been that the chair has appointed.
Thank you, Tamara, for making that point, because it actually does say right there on the agenda, Chairman Short appoints representative. Thank you very much. Terry, you're already on the stakeholders group, is that correct? You're not, so there will be a county representative for the stakeholders.
There is a supervisor panel on the representative.
And you would be the Transportation Commission's representative then, in addition. That being said, I think being the ranking member, I agree that you would be the best choice for that position, so I will make that appointment. Mr. Hemmingson as the Transportation Commission's representative to the stakeholders group.
Thank you. Is there room for an alternate, Tamara? Do they ask for an alternate?
They don't ask for an alternate. Yeah.
Thank you, Chairman. Moving on to...
Thank you, Chairman.
You're absolutely welcome, sir. Moving on to item F, Cooper Avenue Project Update. See, Mr. Weir just stepped in. Perfect timing. Welcome.
Yes, thank you, Chairman Short, members of the commission. Well, I was hoping by this date that we'd be reporting that Cooper Street is done. Unfortunately, Mother Nature has not been so kind to us this winter, as we're all aware. I ran some quick numbers on it this morning just because I've just been in awe of Mother Nature and her all of her fury for Del Norte County and really most of the state this winter. But Gaskey has averaged since October 1st through almost 3/4 of an inch of rain every day until now, through March anyway. Just amazing, and I kind of just when I looked at that number, just kind of a staggering amount of rain. Nonetheless, county crews, city crews have worked well on Cooper. It's been a while since I've given the Transportation Commission an update. I'm fortunate enough to be able to give the City Council an update about every couple of weeks, but we've only had really about 1 week of good weather. That week was right in the beginning of January, or right at the end of January, I think is when it was. County crews were able to get the culvert in. Culvert's been replaced throughout the road. The 24-inch water main was removed, then restored. The 6-inch gravity sewer main was bypassed and then put back in place. 2-inch gas lines back in place. We tried to put some temporary paving down just because we knew the weather wasn't going to be the best. Unfortunately, that temporary paving didn't last just due to the complete saturation of the road base. So we had to go to Plan B. We went to that, waited for a couple of days of good weather, which we actually received this last week. We rebuilt the structural section of the road. So we dug it down about 2.5 feet. We put geofabric down. We put 3-inch minus rock down to about a foot deep throughout the roadbed, followed that with 3/4-inch minus, and then utilized that asphalt that we put down earlier. We ground it up, mixed it in with the base, and so that created a very sound structural section that was a little bit more resistant to the water than what had previously been there. So that was done. We were able to coordinate with the concrete contractor, and so we poured curb and gutter and sidewalk on curb and gutter on both sides of the road, sidewalk on the north side of the road. So that was done last week, with the last step just being paving the road. So we just need a couple of good days of weather now. We're satisfied with the road section. It's compact. We get some good weather, and the asphalt plant's running, we'll be able to pave it and open it soon. So we're hopeful for possibly the end of April, as the next 2 weeks still don't look very good. So we'll see. But as soon as we can get it done, we'll get it done. We asked for $200,000 from the commission to cover costs. Recently worked out a cost estimate with Jeff Daniels, the county road superintendent. Currently, we're at somewhere around $160,000 on the project. So I'm predicting that it will come in under budget. We'll be somewhere around $180,000, $185,000 when it's all said and done. So it's been a good project. Definitely been a great working relationship between the city and county. And Mother Nature has put us to the test, but we'll get it open as soon as we can. Questions?
Thank you, Eric. Anything from the commission?
Sure.
Go ahead.
The senior members.
Pardon me.
I get to pull that card now. That's great.
Is this a long in the tooth?
A little long in the tooth. I'm all of that. The work that's done, that's being done on 101 northbound.
By Walgreens?
Yes. Is that a culvert failure, or is that all part of this same drainage?
It's not part of this drainage. It's a sub drainage that ends up feeding back into Elk Creek. It's a Caltrans project that picks up drainage right around that Walgreens area. So this drainage flows through the county yard and then actually crosses the highway kind of by the Club Fitness right there, and then comes in right on the south side of the fairgrounds. So it's just that is just north of the Caltrans project you're talking about.
So has that created a part of an issue with that drainage also?
No, it's the aging of the infrastructure. So Caltrans took it on once they found out that culvert was in need of being replaced, and so they were working on that. City crews did work with Caltrans because fortunately we had a street light go down right in that same area. A vehicular accident happened and took out the street light, so we were able to work with them and replace that at the same time.
Thank you.
You said something during your presentation, and it's occurred to me that I don't know the answer to this question, so I'm hoping you do. Gas lines.
Yes.
So is that ours? Who owns the gas lines that run throughout our community?
So the gas distribution system is operated, maintained, and owned by Blue Star Gas. So it's a propane, it's not natural gas, it's propane. The Blue Star is the only company that actually has underground lines, and they're not in every area or every street in the city. They have just their certain distribution mains, mainly in the downtown area, but there is a 2-inch line that runs down Cooper and actually feeds Home Depot.
Oh, no kidding.
So during this project, we needed to work with them. Blue Star placed temporary propane tanks on the backside of the store so they could operate during the downtime.
Do you know when those went in? Out of curiosity,
the temporary tanks?
No, the network of gas lines throughout the community.
Oh gosh, they're a long time ago, and I know that
it originally done by Blue Star? Or?
Gosh, I don't know if Blue Star was the original company that put those in or not, but they've owned them for a long time. I know when we were dealing with the 2011 tsunami, gas lines and just gas infrastructure is a big deal and created a lot of problems in 64. And Blue Star was the company that was operating them during the 64 tsunami.
I'll be darned. Thanks. Appreciate that.
Great job.
Okay. Any other questions for Eric?
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Yep.
This is an information-only item. We'll go ahead and move on to the next item on the agenda. Authorize a license agreement with Commonplace. Camera.
So the Technical Advisory Committee, or TAC, has done a significant amount of work on this project over the last couple of months. We've done a lot of agency or product reviews. This is really a product that we're purchasing a license agreement to use. We've done a lot of product reviews, trying to determine the most, the best fit for our community, the service that we think that we need to help inform specific projects, but mostly to help inform our 2020 regional transportation plan over time. So this product will focus on specific areas when we want to make that designation, but when it comes time to adopting our regional transportation plan in 2020, we will have years of public comment, not just public comment from public meetings during a certain time. We've talked about this a lot in the commission since June, and one of the areas that I think will be a good focus area is our problem area of Elk Valley Crossroad and US 199, but appropriate for all areas in the community. If somebody has some comment on the accident, you know, accidents or the concerns about post-mile 10.5 on 199, or, you know, some of the construction that's happening on Last Chance Grade, or, you know, the Gateway area comes up frequently as being a really good project that could be informed by the crowdsourcing tool that is commonplace. So the TAC has really put a lot of work into evaluating tools. I think this is going to be a good product. If the agreement is authorized, they're ready to start now, and they anticipate having the product up and available possibly by the end of May and no later than the end of June. So it's really going to happen pretty quickly. And so I'm very encouraged by it, and I'm looking forward to moving forward and giving our community yet another way to provide public comment for concerns or accolades that they have for transportation in a region.
Chair, I'd move to approve to execute the license agreement with Commonplace USA.
We've got a motion to
second.
Approve and a second. Do we have any public comment on this item?
Hi, Alan Cooper. When I went to the TAC meeting time before this, I gave suggestion which was embraced by the consultant making the presentation on the crowdsourcing idea, and that is, you have a screen right out here in the hallway, and you could have people enter the crowdsourcing, you know, information into there, so that it would be great publicity for the public when they always come here. And you already have a screen, so use it. It's never in use. So thank you.
Thank you, Eileen. Any more public comment? Seeing none, we'll bring it back to the commission. Is there any more comments on this item? Nicole, would you mind polling the vote?
Commissioner Keim?
Yes.
Commissioner Howard?
Yes.
Policy Advisory Member Robertson?
Yes.
Commissioner Hemmingson?
Yes.
Commissioner Gitlin?
Yes.
Commissioner Fallman?
Yes.
Chairman Short?
Yes. Okay, passes unanimously. Moving on down the agenda, item H, the Transportation Development Act funding allocation and fund estimate.
Okay. Pamela? Let me get to this here because this gets a little complicated.
No kidding. Oh, excuse me.
I can just do it from memory. I got my agenda all out of order. here it is. Okay. Shuffling paper. The Transportation Development Act fund estimate is something that we take up every year, typically earlier in the year, but oftentimes the state is late getting numbers to the auditor's office, and in this year we have had some sort of additional challenges in bringing together the fund estimate in a way that we believe is as accurate as possible. The background information in your staff report is really pretty important to understand the way the TDA works for rural communities. The TDA is essentially transit funding, and the TDA is a state law, provides us our transit funding. There are other programs that come through the TDA. There are some federal funding that comes through the TDA, but it is essentially state-funded Transportation Development Act. The funding formula that is represented in the third page, that is really just a spreadsheet, we use this formula. And this formula, all of the numbers that are in here are determined by statute about how this formula works. So at the top of the page, I put in the numbers, or the auditor puts in the numbers that he receives from the state of California about our anticipated revenues. And then we put in the administrative and planning number. That number is essentially unchanged over time. There are certain requirements that the Transportation Commission has for administering the TDA that are in statute. You know, most of the money in this is spent in audits, the TDA audits that are a requirement. Some of it is staff time and coordination for things that are not allowable anywhere else in the work program that have to do with transit funding, transit coordination. Some of it with our Social Services Transportation Advisory Council that comes under this work. And then the Ped Bike Fund is 2% of the TDA funds is the Ped Bike Funds. And that is especially important today because the Robo Coast Transit Authority is experiencing, by no fault of their own, $178,000 shortfall in funding because of some missteps that the state of California took in overextending funds in a certain way for transit. So now they and other transit agencies across the state are finding themselves with a significant shortfall. And the Robo Coast Transit Authority is needing to work within its budget for providing transit services in the next year, reflecting the fund estimate. So I took this topic to the TAC and I said, you know, there are several things that we can do to help transit out for 1 year only, to give them a little bit of extra ground. One of the things that the Technical Advisory Committee voted to do and to support is to not take the $11,173 for Ped Bike funds out of the TDA for 1 year only. Now, we really do need that money, and as Joe Rye, the transit manager, acknowledges, you know, nearly all transit starts and stops with a pedestrian or a bicyclist. And, you know, and that indeed is true. He's, you know, he's a very strong advocate of pedestrian and bicycle resources in our community. You know, and the city and county staff all know, you know, how hard this money is to come by. But we have, as an example, the RSTP funding. If we needed that for match, we do have some Ped Bike funding right now, $20,000 in our reserves for Ped Bike. That money is typically used for match for grant applications, but we have an alternative should we need it for 1 year only. So the Technical Advisory Committee recommended that we do not allocate the 2% for Ped Bike purposes for 1 year only. That money runs through the spreadsheet and ends up on the within the funding of Robo Coast Transit Authority. In addition to that, the CTSA, who is right now Sutter Coast Hospital, has said that they wouldn't need their full allocation for their patient program, the Bring Their Patients Home program that we are in partnership with them on. And in fact, they may not need the $10,000 at all for that program. But we don't want to leave that program hanging should that money be needed. So we thought we would set the money aside. If we end up not needing it, we won't put forward a resolution, and the money will go back to Robo Coast Transit Authority through this formula too. So I'm a little bit surprised, but also really quite pleased that the TAC was willing to come together and say, you know what, this really is important. This $10,000 will help reduce the reductions that transit will need to make regardless. And I think it's a really important and collaborative step for the TAC to make, who really, you know, the city, the county, the public works departments in different jurisdictions in our community really can benefit from that money. But I think they recognize that it's right now it's the higher level of importance for that money is to go directly to transit.
Chair, I'd like to make a motion at this time for us to omit the pedestrian bicycle allocation for 1 year only and prepare that corresponding TDA resolution for a future meeting, and that amount would be $11,173.
Seconded.
Motion's been made and seconded. Is there any public comment on the admission of these funds? Any further discussion from the commission? Nicole, would you pull the vote, please?
Commissioner Gitlin?
Yes.
Commissioner Howard?
Yes.
Commissioner Keim?
Yes.
Commissioner Hemmingson?
Yes.
Policy Advisory Member Robertson?
Yes.
Commissioner Fallman?
Yes.
Chairman Short?
Yes. And that one also passes unanimously. Thank you. Moving on to letter I, the direction for style of minutes and minutes of March 8th, 2017.
So this topic has come up with Nicole and I. It has been the practice of the commission in the past to have minutes for the meeting that reflect the actions of the group, reflect some significant, if there are significant comments in the minutes that we believe are most important to be noted, if somebody objects to an action that's being taken, that kind of thing, rather than a transcript of the meeting itself. But Nicole has received directly some questions from commissioners about the style of minutes that are received. So I need direction because while Nicole works for the commission, she reports to me, and the two of us need to be on the same page about the type of minutes. So we really need some direction from the commission about what you need and what you'd like for the minutes to be, and then Nicole and I will work out moving it forward.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead, Mr. Hemmings.
Are these meetings recorded?
Yes.
So there's no reason to have a written transcript. You can always go back to the recording if need be. I'm certainly in favor of very short, concise minutes. And even though I don't know the robbers' rules of order, mm-hmm. I think you mean Roberts, not robbers.
Thank you.
I think we probably should adhere to that.
Thank you, Mr. Hemmings. Mr. Gitlin, you have a comment?
Well, actually, it's actually Rosenberg's rules of orders, because Rosenberg's is the concise, it's a matter of a few pages. Roberts' rules is a book as thick as a dictionary. So I would identify, because that's what our Board of Supervisors uses, I believe that's what the City Council uses, is Rosenberg's. Yeah. So I would certainly think that's clean and efficient, and I would make that motion based on using the format offered by the Rosenberg's Rules of Orders. So there you go. That's my motion.
I believe both versions adhere to the same idea of the minutes reflecting what was done at the meeting and not as we're saying, not a transcript of the meeting. So both having similar ideas about the meeting minutes, I don't think that's part of necessarily part of our consensus that we adhere to one rules or the other. Yeah.
It was really, honestly, with my research, this is what came up about the most common meeting minutes. I just wanted to, figure out, present to you what is the most common. When I did a little bit of research, the Roberts rules came up.
Are those the rules that we adhere to in this commission? The Roberts, or do we use Rosenberg?
We have never switched to the Rosenbergs, but I don't think that there's a specific reason to either.
I agree, Mr. Gillis, correct, with the City Council. And
yeah. Well, I think we should be.
It is Rosenberg's, but I believe it's neither here nor there. Yeah. Mr. Fallman, do you have a comment?
Yeah, what are we legally required to have in our minutes? Is there like a bare minimum legal requirement of what needs to be in there?
The bare minimum of what needs to be in there are actions taken, a motion, a second, a polled vote on items that involve allocations, mm-hmm. and that's really it. I mean, we could have a one paragraph minutes if we wanted to do the bare minimum. They could be extremely short, but that's mm-hmm. the minimum allowable by probably by statute.
Yeah.
For the commission.
Okay, I'll open this up for public comment. I know Mr. Lonsdale has some comments on this item.
Chairman, members of the board, my name is Bill Lonsdale and I live in Crescent City. This may seem trite, but back during the Johnson administration, when I was a brand new second lieutenant, a grizzled old sergeant major gave me some advice that has stuck with me ever since. He said, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And it's in that spirit that I'd like to request that you consider keeping the minutes the way they are, and I'll tell you why. Under Ms. Bersham and before that under Ms. Phillips, we, your board, had some of the most comprehensive, clear, accessible record of it, of your actions that I've ever seen. And accessibility to the public is important. The minutes need to reflect the entire context of your decision making, not just the result. We need to know why you voted the way you voted, not just that you voted a certain way. Or took a certain action. Beyond that, if you switch to the action record format, what else is lost? What is lost is the byplay between the board and staff, questions and answers, between the board and consultants that may testify before you, questions and answers, between the public and the board, and within the board itself, who has reservations, who has a better idea. None of that shows up in an action summary. And to say, and I would concede, as Commissioner Hemmingson has said, that if we, an audio record is sufficient. But I can tell you, having served on a grand jury that researched 10 years worth of records on the sewer plant, when most of what was available was an audio record, that is not accessible. If I wanted to know what happened at today's meeting and Ms. Bersham was writing minutes, I would know. But if we had an action summary, in order to find out, I'd have to go and dig out the audio tape, assuming, and now let's look at the historical record. Some of what we looked at were reel-to-reel, and some of what we looked at were cassettes. Now, where is that in today's technology? If your board were to have live streaming and archive video on Ustream or YouTube, the way the Board of Supervisors does, then an action summary would be sufficient, and that's what they use, I think.
Yeah. We do have that.
But the rec.
We do yeah. have that.
But you know, it would almost take that to replace the minutes the way they are now, and so I'd ask you to consider that very carefully. And adopt a course of action that keeps your record open, accessible, and transparent. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lonsdale.
Yeah, I apologize for interrupting. I should have.
Just any further public comment?
I guess, Eileen Cooper, I appreciate getting sent the agendas and all the background information ahead of time, and Tamara takes the time to send that out to a huge list of people. But I haven't checked your website in a while, but most recently I still see that we lag getting out on the website, so that someone who's new, you know, to the community can click on the Transportation Commission site and find out what's happening at the very next meeting without being on the special list. So I just urge to keep that as updated as the Board of Supervisors does. It's very valuable to the public. And I agree with Mr. Lonsdale that there's a lot that goes into decision making. And even if there was the audio and video record, I think sometimes written is easier when you're reviewing a long history. So thank you.
Thank you. Just as a point of clarification during...
As a point of clarification, our meetings are videoed. They appear on the channel, just like the City Council meetings, the County Board of Supervisor meetings. You can access them for approximately 6 months in the past. So you can go back, you know, for approximately 6 months of meetings. I've tried to look just recently beyond June 30th, and I couldn't find the meetings prior to June 30th. So what you do adopt in your minutes becomes the public record. I mean, the audio videotapes are helpful, and, you know, and frankly, I haven't had anybody ask me for old minutes. I mean, it doesn't come up. If somebody wants to see a meeting within the past 2 months or 3 months, it could come up, say, within the past quarter, what happened in this meeting. But anything older than 3 months really hasn't, by practice, come up. The minutes are available, though. I routinely produce the minutes for audits, as an example. When we have our triennial performance audit, every agenda and minutes of the meeting are reviewed by the auditors to ensure that we are accomplishing our obligations in the regional or in the work program. So, you know, that is really the only time that I have ever accessed minutes that are older than a quarter is from the triennial performance audits that we do. But it's, you know, frankly, it's less staff time to do a transcript of the meeting. I mean, you don't actually have to think, you just have to type. It, you know, so there's no, there's a, you know, there's, it's harder to write briefer minutes. That's the, if I had more time, I would have written a shorter letter comment. But you know, my preference would be to reflect the Rosenberg's or Roberts rules of order. It seems to be a better practice, and I think that there's some good reasons for that. But I also respect the will of the public, and so really I don't have any kind of strong preference. My preference would be for all of us to be on the same page about what you want, what you want and need from Nicole and I, so we have some common ground about what we're providing to you.
Mr. Hemingway.
Thank you. Mr. Lonsdale, thank you for your service. I kind of have to agree with if it ain't broke, don't fix it attitude, and if what's working for the public is working and it's less staff time to do the way that you're saying that it's being done now?
Writing a transcript of the meeting is much less staff time than writing minutes for the meeting.
You know, this is not for our edification. I mean, we know what's going on. We're here. You know, we're here in person. It's for the people who are not here that are reading the minutes that I think is important. And so if that's what it takes to make the public happy, then and that's the least amount of staff time, the easiest thing to do, I would go with whatever is the least amount of resistance person. Whether that adheres to Rosenberg's or Roberts, however, I'm certainly in favor of that.
Is there any other comment? Mr. Gitlin.
I'm going to chime in, Mr. Lonsdale, with all due respect. I'm not sure if I'd want to know why someone voted a certain way. I might be careful how you peel the onion back here. I think we need to keep it simple. And, you know, again, Board of Supervisors meeting, we usually have a number of people here, fill up the room. With the demand, not to minimize your participation, or Ms. Cooper here, your participation here, but we generally don't have a great audience here. So I'd like to just keep this thing simple and have summaries. If it's on video, then there is a record of it, and someone can search that either on YouTube or on Ustream. So let's not create more work for you, Tamara or Nicole, and they keep this simple and have simple summaries, as we do on our Board of Supervisors and as I see you do on the City Council. So I would say keep the model as is, and you have short summaries, and if someone wants more information, they can certainly research it, and it's available. Up to, what, 6 months? They can do that. I don't see this as being a practice that's going to be utilized a lot by the public, but there will be the occasional person who will want to research something, and I think that's fair. But to jump through a lot of hoops and create more work for you folks, I'm not on board with. with that.
Well, I think, Mr. Gitlin, I think you said it was not more work to do the transcript the way it's currently,
oh, is
currently
going. Let me understand this, because we do this on our yeah. own board. Our board clerk makes summaries. Mm-hmm. You don't, that's not easy to do. Someone said this or someone said that. That would be more cumbersome to you. Is that what you're saying?
It takes more judgment. It takes more work to summarize a meeting and take minutes than it does to write a virtual transcript of the meeting. With a transcript of the meeting, there's not a lot of analysis or thinking about what could have been important. Where did the decision change? You just type what you hear. And so it's actually, I mean, it's not a lot of work to type
right.
what you hear.
Then I'm going to defer to what you are doing. You are doing the work. We're not. So if you feel this is the way you should go to go the transcript mess, I would support that. And I presume, Nicole, you want to create less work too. So I would go with the transcript model rather than the summaries.
I think the only thing necessary is the very small action items. However, our two most engaged community members have voiced their opinion. I'm agreeing with Mr. Hemmingson, and what Chairman's saying is the easiest way. As far as I'm concerned, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Consensus?
Do we have a consensus
yeah.
for there?
Yep.
Consensus is
okay. So we'll have by consensus we'll have more lengthy, quite thorough minutes, and if there gets to a point where we want to make that change. But I appreciate the direction, because it's been causing some confusion, and there has been some questions coming up all around. So we will produce more thorough minutes similar to the ones that are in your agenda packet today, which I'm hoping we will accept.
In all the committees and boards that I've been on, this is definitely the one that is different than the others. Mm-hmm. But if that's the way we want to keep it, then that's the way we'll keep it. Okay. Moving on to item J, discussion items.
Could we accept the minutes?
Oh, I'm
thank
sorry.
You.
That is part of this item. Is
okay. Did we accept the minutes? Okay.
By consensus.
By consensus, that is also
I do remember
part of
doing
it.
That.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, now moving on to J.
The State Transportation Innovation Council has a local roadway departure safety workshop, and we have been asked to host one of these meetings. We are on their schedule to host a meeting on July 17th, and I have agreed to make the contribution to our community to host this workshop. I won't be speaking at the workshop. I will help the group coordinate a site. It will most likely happen at the Lighthouse Inn. They've got a pretty good sized community room there. We're looking at different options, but it's very comfortable there for folks coming in. There's coffee and tea and that kind of thing. It's a pretty lengthy workshop, starting at 8 in the morning to 3 in the afternoon, so some of those comforts can be important for the folks. But I'm not making the decisions about where. I'm offering options, and the folks who are bringing the workshop in will be making the decisions. They expect there to be anywhere from 20 to 70 folks attending the workshop. We'll know more as we get closer to it. The local roadway departures are the driving off the roadway single car accidents that we have at a higher rate than just about anywhere else in the state of California. That's one of the reasons why Del Norte has been selected from, different from other areas. So there are other areas with higher accident rates, although I must say we are pretty high at the top of that list also for accidents on the state highway system. I think Trinity and Humboldt right now are higher than we are, but I haven't looked at a recent list either. So, we're kind of all go back and forth in terms of, who is at the top of that list. It is very commonly Trinity that is at the top of the list for highest injury fatality rates on the state highway system. Lake 20 is also a very dangerous highway, and they float near the top there also. But we'll be hosting this meeting in July, on July 17th, and I just thought I would give you all an early notice that we'll be bringing many folks to our community. They wanted to hold it on a Monday. July 17th is a Monday because in working in collaboration with the Visitor Bureau in spirit, we are having them stay an extra day. And a lot of folks in July want to beat the heat, come to the community, stay an extra day or 2 days, spend the weekend with their families, and then attend their work meeting on Monday. So not everybody will be doing that, but that is the reason, one of the reasons why they wanted to have it in Crescent City and have it on a Monday, so they could come to the community and, you know, get away from where many of them are in a hotter urban area.
Cool. Great. Thank you.
So, and any questions about the STIC workshop? A new acronym, STIC. State Transportation Innovation Council.
Questions? No?
Nope. No? The Crescent City Non-Motorized Improvement Project, I included some of the information in your agenda packet about this, and in addition to that, I prepared a new format and printed out, if anybody in the audience wants one, I have a couple extra, the stages of highway development. And this is very small. I originally received this on a 11 by 17 format, but I scanned it in, and I think it's a really good tool. I've been using it for about 10 years now to explain to folks how the state highway system is built. Projects on our local roadway system happen in a similar way, but not identical to this. So if you'll look at the beginning, you'll see the needs analysis. That's where transportation planning is. Elk Valley Road, for example, would be under needs analysis. That's what we do as a regional transportation planning agency. When we do a planning document, we identify needs. The project initiation or PID documents is where we are right now with Last Chance Grade. It's also where we are with the Highway 101 Crescent City Gateway. And we have PID documents for the non-motorized project as well as any other project that's moved forward. So when we're talking, for example, 4 years ago, and I said to the community who were at that time outraged that we don't actually have a project for Last Chance Grade, we don't actually have a project until we have a project initiation document or a PID document. That's what really starts a project within the state highway system. You get a project number and you have an ability to program that project. Programming is a convoluted word for getting money. So bear with me. This is my low-level talk, non-tech talk about stages of highway development. You can't program a project until you have project initiation documents, not for a city project, a county project, anybody's project. You have to have a PID. There are different levels of PID documents that you can produce. You can produce very small 2-3-page project initiation documents for smaller projects that are, funded with local funds within the city's jurisdiction, for example. It's not always this lengthy document that we have for Last Chance Grade. The 101 PID document, I brought a few copies of them if any of you would like to see them. The project initiation documents, I've got several of these, but if you'd like to borrow a copy, keep it for a few months or whatever, you're welcome to them. The project initiation document makes the project eligible to receive funding. It really gets down into the detail where we could fund it with state or federal funding. The permits and studies is essentially the environmental phase. The right-of-way phase is next. The PS&E or design phase and the project construction phase are generally the four phases of highway development that we talk about once a project has been programmed or funded. So you have environmental, design, right-of-way, and construction as four phases of highway development. Some of those phases can happen simultaneously. There's not like a clear line between right-of-way and design, as an example. So there are some things that happen simultaneously, but typically you cannot move forward with a phase until that phase of a project is fully funded. So for example, you couldn't partially fund right-of-way. You couldn't go to the California Transportation Commission and ask for partial right-of-way funding. They have as a requirement that you fully fund that phase. So when we talk about developing a large project on the state highway system, and we'll say fully fund a phase, that's what we're talking about. You're either fully funding environmental, design, right-of-way, or construction. You can fund one phase at a time, you can fund two phases at a time, but you cannot fund a partial phase. In the same way that you really don't do a partial planning document or a partial PID document, you fully fund the project initiation document, otherwise you can't ask for money for it. So in taking a look at how this works with the Crescent City non-motorized project, they have the needs identified, they have the project initiation documents are done, and they've programmed the document, they've programmed the project, so they have the project as they originally designed it is funded with essentially with ADA money, and that's the in-between the areas of Gateway. What we tried to do is include, after that project was funded, we wanted to include the Gateway areas in the project that Caltrans had funded for the in-between areas for the, you know, what's essentially an ADA project funded with targeted ADA money. It would have helped the Gateway area. It wouldn't have solved the Gateway problem. It probably wouldn't have put in a lighted crosswalk, but it would have had move that project forward a bit in the Gateway areas too. That request has been denied now by the state to expand the limits of the project to include the Gateway areas. I don't think that we should let that go. I was a little frustrated even at the time because Caltrans moved forward with developing the PID without my participation on that work group. That wouldn't have happened today. There isn't any staff working with Del Norte at Caltrans right now who moved that project forward without consulting us. And I don't think that any of the staff that we have right now at Caltrans, I don't think that that would happen. I think that we have a significant better communication with Brad Medham coming to Caltrans District 1. He's been much more collaborative with the RTPAs for work on the state highway system. It's not wrong that they didn't come to us, you know, in any kind of technical term, but it's not as collaborative as we would like to be or even as we are today. And I think with the Gateway project being our number two unfunded project, it really merits a second look from Caltrans to find a way to fund at least the ADA accessibility in those areas of our community, because we do have a high level of pedestrian and bicyclists on our Gateway areas. So on the natural, you might think it would be in the in-between areas, but I'm not sure that the reality is that. We have a lot of pedestrian and bicycle traffic at the harbor area and at our North Gateway area, folks coming, going to Walmart as an example. So the ADA project is moving forward. It's a really significant project. You can see the scope and the funding. It's several million dollars of pedestrian facilities in the in-between areas. I think it's a great benefit to our community, but it's not all that we need. So how the Traffic Calming Gateway project fits into that, the Traffic Calming Gateway project is much broader than an ADA project, but it still could have been moved forward. This project remains our number two priority project in the regional transportation plan, just behind the last chance grade. But right now there really isn't any money in the state for transportation projects of any nature. They're really trying to keep up with the mandated safety projects right now. So there's not a lot of work that isn't really targeted work, like the ADA funding came in as targeted work in the state. Maybe with some movement, some steps that the state appears to be taking with transportation, we might be able to move that project forward. I think that we need to continue to ask Caltrans to prioritize the Gateway project. It is on the state highway system. It is within their jurisdiction. All of the scope of work within the Gateway project wouldn't be Caltrans' obligation, but the parts that are not Caltrans' obligation are very minor for the total, when considering the total scope of work. It's some signage, that kind of thing, that could perhaps fall to the Transportation Commission to find a way to fund. So that's where we are with the how the ADA project fits in with the Gateway project and moving it forward. Now, if you look at your stages of highway development chart, you can see we have project initiation documents, but we don't have programming. Programming is funding for the Gateway. And I think that the best thing that we can do for the project, the Gateway project, is continue to bring it to the attention of Caltrans. And, you know, I certainly do in my meetings with Caltrans, but the commission, whenever you can, the project will also really benefit from our crowdsourcing tool. So when things come up in the community, we soon will be able to direct folks to their smartphones. You know, nearly everybody, and certainly not everybody, but nearly everybody in the community has a smartphone. There's also free public access to the internet from the at the public library and many other areas in the community, and anybody can ask me. I have on many occasions met with folks at the public library as, you know, a central meeting place, to help them to access information on the Caltrans website, as an example. It teaches them how to access the information independently, but I absolutely go meet them there at the public library. We sign up for a free computer, and then they can do it independently into the future. So, you know, I'm happy to sit down with somebody in my office and type for them, but I think it's more enabling to show them how to do it in the public library and within the resources that we have. So that's coming up, has come up on many times in the community in the past 10 years, I'd say. More than half a dozen, less than 12, but more than six in the last few years. And so that's where we are with the pedestrian project, with the Gateway project, how they fit together, and I'd answer any questions if I could.
Mr. Gitlin, now you have
one. I'm lost. I heard your words.
I get it.
I asked this to be agendized as a separate item. We've had constituent calls who've asked me about a lighted crosswalk on 101 South, right near the Fisherman Restaurant. People crossing over and they run for their lives. That's highway traffic going south. So I asked for, and I know of only three that are in our market, one on Washington Boulevard, one on North Crest, and I think there's a third one on 101 North near the mobile home park. I'd like to know about the feasibility, the study, about implementing a study to see about a lighted crosswalk right near Bayside Realty. Across there is a crosswalk there. People have complained to me, they've talked to me, they say it's dangerous. I have talked to Commander DP at Highway Patrol. He says that it is a concern. They don't have records on accidents at this point, but I would like to prevent that first accident from happening. And if this board feels so inclined to move forward for a study, and I don't know the funding availability, to consider studying a lighted crosswalk at 101 South, right near Bayside, catty corner to it, was the Fisherman's Restaurant, then I'd like to move forward and get a report to see if that's feasible.
Okay, so how that works is that Caltrans is the owner and operator of the state highway system, and these are state highway system facilities, that we would have to have enough accidents and injuries to initiate, have the reason to take a look at putting in a lighted crosswalk in there. Even though we had many accidents at the North Gateway, it really took quite a while. It took 4 years of advocacy with the accidents and fatalities to get that HOCK system at the North Gateway. I think a HOCK system at the South Gateway would probably be the most likely way to go, because Caltrans has commented many times that they prefer to be consistent in a community. The drivers and the pedestrians learn how a system works, so it works better when you have the same kind of system throughout a community rather than different kinds of systems. But the request would go to Caltrans District 1. Most likely David Morgan could comment on this. Again, he has commented on it in the past that without the injuries and fatalities, they can't just go in and study something because we ask. They have to have a basis for studying it. And for something like the HOCK system, it has to be a record of injuries and fatalities to do so. That it's unfortunate, but that's most often the way the money works. And Jesse, can please step in if you have something to add that's different from his.
Well, I think that there's other avenues that you could pursue. There's you know, you could do a project through an encroachment permit process. So if a local agency had some funding, or if, you know, whether that's the city of Crescent City, I'm not really that familiar with the location you guys are talking about, but there are some other avenues that you can consider. you know, you can use LTF 2% funds potentially, maybe not this year, but there are some funds. You could look maybe to HSIP funds and look at things. I don't know if they would permit another Hawk signal. Some treatments I wouldn't get attached to, and you can work with Caltrans to describe the problems and see if they can they mm-hmm. can come up with something that might reasonably meet some of your concerns. It could be, a lighted crosswalk could be a rapid flashing beacon, mm-hmm. Around a high visibility mm-hmm. sign. So it wouldn't, so if you're considering, high speeds, you might look at, you're talking about gateway treatment. Right. I don't know if you guys are considering a roundabout or anything like that, but you might consider a number of different mm-hmm. treatments, and then depending on, the accidents, if there are accident severity or frequency, that might justify some funds. If not, there's a number of ways to do it. I wouldn't get wrapped up on saying we need a Hawk signal.
Mm-hmm. Right. The project initiation documents that we have, they include all kinds of alternatives for that location. They have a proposed crosswalk. Our ped bike funds are, as we just discussed, are $11,000 a year, so it's not really viable for us to spend our 2% TDA funds because we get so little. Some of the other funding could potentially, like the HSIP funding, could potentially fund something like this if the county were to agree to be the lead agency on it. But the county has not agreed to put county resources and county funding on the state highway system. They have considered that in the past, and they don't agree to do that at this time. They have, their own off-highway system needs that they're addressing. So I hear what you're saying, but I think that right now where we are on this project is that there are all kinds of alternatives identified in the PID documents, and that our most likely way to move forward with this is for Caltrans to work with us in owning the problem, as they own the state highway system, and not to expect the county, as an example, or the harbor, I think it would be the county, though, to, take on this project on the state highway system.
If I may just interject, and again, this is inquiries to me. I would like to see this studied. I don't know what the criteria are to have the matter studied, but immediately after the North illuminated crosswalk was in, there was a fatal the next week. I mean, they put it in, it was working, and then someone was killed mm-hmm. crossing mm-hmm. across the street there. So I don't know if the area has even been studied.
The area has been studied, and that's what's in the, we have two phases of studies for this project already. We have the planning documents and the project initiation documents both. And I can get those documents to you in paper so you can comfortably take a look at them without having them up on your computer. So if you'd like to do that, but we've spent actually quite a lot of time and money studying the gateway area and putting forward an alternative. Right now it's ready for funding because it does have an eligible project initiation document. Caltrans worked very closely with us in developing those PID documents, and they contributed funding to developing the PID documents. So the studies, the projects are ready for moving forward because we have project initiation documents. What the Transportation Commission could do within our own jurisdiction is we do essentially planning, programming, and monitoring. We've done the planning. We have done the project initiation. We could program, which means to fund, but we don't have an eligible fund source, and the county is hesitant to step up and take on a project on the state highway system. So what we can do, though, is continue to encourage Caltrans to do that. I can send yet another letter to Mr. Morgan, but reflect on the conversation he had with us just a month or so ago about the gateway area, we are having trouble getting ground on an area where we do have accidents and fatalities. So I think that the transportation funding in the state of California is so low right now that it's really hard to get anything that some folks would see as extra done. Now, it's not extra to us. It's the number two priority project for us. I wouldn't call that an extra, but when you compare to it to what's happening across the state of California, it seems like an extra. So continuing to prioritize the project, continuing to advocate for a solution on it, I think is our best chance of getting it done. You know, to bring it up in the deal meetings, if the county can do that, to continue to ask David Morgan questions.
Chair, if I may, yep. And I think the importance of Commissioner Gitlin's comments are good, and it brings his attention to where we've been almost for now for 5 years. Mm-hmm. He's now catching up with the idea that we've put together the Gateway Study, which also encompasses the specific area he's referring to. Mm-hmm. And as you've repeated here today, it's going to be really our job, not as the owners of the state highway, but our job as local transportation commissioners to really advocate to whoever is going to be able to listen to us to fund this project. We have brought it as far as we can at this point. Mm-hmm. We really need to start advocating, and I understand where the commissioner is coming from. I mean, we've got other very important spots that I did not mm-hmm. see put on the discussion list today, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. I'm assuming because it might have been a too lengthy of a meeting to add those back on there, but we could get to that in a minute. But mm-hmm. I want the commissioner to understand that we have brought those specific projects in the form of this Gateway Study to the forefront. We need funding, and we need all the commissioners' help to help advocate for that position with the state of California, with Caltrans, to help get this thing going.
Well, maybe the harbor should be part of this discussion, because they've expressed mm-hmm. concern yeah. on this particular intersection yeah. too. So perhaps an outreach can be done to yeah. them.
Well, I have attended several harbor meetings, two harbor meetings in the last 3 months, and I am working to get letters of support with the harbor director. The harbor director is working with me to get letters of support. I've written some draft letters for his consideration. I believe he's sharing those. He's getting signatures from folks in the South Gateway area. So, you know, those steps have already taken place in collaboration with the harbor and my work with Charlie Helms. He sits, the harbor sits on the technical advisory committee, so we talk about it at the TAC level pretty frequently too.
Further comment? Go ahead. Another aspect of our advocacy is this crowdsourcing tool that mm-hmm. that we're talking about now. The Haven mm-hmm. family was here in, you know, meetings earlier this year, last year, after losing a family member there, and their question was, does Caltrans consider close calls? We know that there's accident triggers that or accident numbers that trigger studies, and that Caltrans pays attention to those, but that was that question. What mm-hmm. what about the close calls? I'm right there next to that intersection and see this often. And that's kind of what triggered the crowdsourcing tool inquiry. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where we are now. So we have studied it, and now we're actually going to advocate for some input from the public using this crowdsourcing tool.
Mr. Chairman,
tools.
Even extra for CHP patrol and a notation of speeding tickets along that area. Is there a back to speeding problem? I think there is.
Yeah.
I mean, these are things that I think we can do and be helpful on so that we can perhaps, mm-hmm. we don't have a death yet, I don't know, yeah. we can prevent that person, tourist going across the street and getting run over.
The speeding studies and the speeding analysis, that's all part of the planning work and the project initiation documents. Those studies are in there, and they're pretty clear. They show where speeding happens at higher levels, and so those two have already been studied and are included in the documents. In terms of the transportation planning grants from Caltrans, those are planning grants, and they result in planning documents. We have completed planning documents and project initiation documents, and I would be hesitant to go back to planning for this area rather than moving forward into funding the project.
Sure. Mr. Howard, do you have further comment?
No, when we're done with this.
Oh, any other comment from the commission about these items? Okay.
So, Chair, I'd like to request for our next meeting under the discussion items, we did have standing items, and two of them fell off. One was last chance grade. Mm-hmm. I want to continue to ensure that that is front and center, especially with four remaining meetings that will be held by the stakeholders group. Mm-hmm. I want those to mm-hmm. be reported out on whenever the stakeholders group happens. The second being our Elk Valley Crossroad intersection. I don't want the Haven family to think that we've forgotten about this. We told mm-hmm. them we'd have it as a standing agenda item. Mm-hmm. I'd like to continue for that to occur, if that's okay with the chair.
I agree.
Yeah, I can do that. They were moved up farther in the agenda, but I can keep them as a standing discussion item, even though they appear elsewhere on the agenda. That's fine.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Okay, moving on down the agenda, commissioner comments and reports. Anything from down this way? Mr. Hemmingson?
Yeah. The 199-197 project, we're waiting on legislation to take care of the NEPA issue mm-hmm. with federal highways. Mm-hmm. That is completed and signed. Mm-hmm. I was told that we would have a almost immediate letter of consensus from NMFS, and mm-hmm. would just like to know if that's happened, and maybe we could put that on the next agenda. So that we can find out where we're at with that.
We are actually planning, our council, Autumn Luna and I are planning on having a closed session item in your next agenda to discuss in detail the potential, the current litigation and the threat of litigation for this project. So you will see that a closed session item at the beginning. We rarely hold them here, but at the beginning of your agenda for the next meeting. We could hold it at the end of the meeting too, if that's your preference, if you have a preference for where you want that on the agenda. Some folks prefer it at the end, but we have already, in conversations with Council Luna, we have already planned agendas that, and we will have an update from our project manager, Kim, at that time also.
Mr. Chairman, in relation, following up with Commissioner Hemmingson's comment on this very subject, I'm told that the federal lawsuit has been dropped, and there's only one existing lawsuit through the state, of which Caltrans has agreed to abide by injunctive relief until this is. Can you update us on that?
Well, where we are right now is there is an injunction in place until the, we talked about this pretty extensively in the last meeting, but I'll try and summarize because I'm not an expert in this area. But there is a current injunction in place that stops work until Caltrans and NOAA Fisheries completes some work and some collaboration between the two agencies. So they're working to complete that work. The signed legislation that Commissioner Hemmingson just mentioned goes into facilitating that process that will be easier to move forward, in that it gives authority for Caltrans to work directly with that agency rather than, you know, going through some federal processes. The injunction remains. There actually isn't an existing lawsuit right now. There is an injunction. There is an injunction halting all work on that project until the Caltrans and NOAA Fisheries satisfies the demands of the court. after they satisfy the demands of the court, which they have been working on for several years now, it's really quite frustrating, then it will, they will submit their documents back to the court, and we start this process over again. We have heard, hence the threat of litigation, from folks who are litigating on this project right now, that they will come back and litigate again. So we are, I have every reason to believe that they will do that, because that's what they said they're going to do, and that's what they've done in the past. Once we will be talking about that process, the threat of litigation, in our closed session in the next meeting, so we'll be able to talk about those steps then. But where we are right now is waiting for Caltrans and NOAA Fisheries to satisfy the demands of the court so we can get back in court.
Thank you, Tamara. Down this way, any other commissioner reports? No? Okay, moving on to item six on the agenda, adjourning as the Policy Advisory Committee and reconvening as the Dillon Local Transportation
Chair, Commission. I'd make the motion to approve and adopt the actions taken by the Policy Advisory Committee.
Got a second. Motion. And a second to approve. Any discussion? Nicole, would you pull the vote, please? Oh, geez. I did it again. Is there any public comment on the items that were discussed as the Policy Advisory Committee? Seeing none. Thank you, Jerry. Nicole, would you pull the vote?
Commissioner Gitlin?
Yes.
Commissioner Hemmingson?
Yes.
Commissioner Vollman?
Yes.
Commissioner Keim?
Yes.
Commissioner Howard?
Yes.
Chairman Short?
Yes. Thank you, Nicole. And with that, we'll adjourn to the regular meeting scheduled Wednesday, May 10th at 3 p.m.